All right, we're supposed to determine if the data is direct variation. If it is, then we have to write the equation. If it's direct variation, it has to fit this equation. Let's just look at this first pair of, you know, x and y. Well, if this is x, and we multiply it by a, and get 20, divide by negative 5, equals negative 4. A would have to be negative 4. If we're going to be able to multiply x by something and get 20, then we have to multiply negative 5 by negative 4. So here's the equation. If it's direct variation, that's it. That has to be the equation. Does it work for every one of these x's?
Yes.
Times negative 4 times negative 4 times negative 4 times negative 4. Yep, they all work. So there it is. The equation for direct variation, it is direct variation.
On mine, I know that I did y divided by negative 4 equals x.
Y divided by
negative 4.
Four. That's your, it looks like this?
Mm-hmm.
It's a 4 out of 5, because this is, you're supposed to find. It's y and x, which is find that a that multiplies by x. And it's just, you know that this is, like all of the same x's and y's work in here. It kind of seems like a bummer to mark it down. But also, there's a language there that if I try to tell you that y varies directly with x, and then if I ask just the right question, then this equation will mess us up a little bit. So. Cost to fill up a gas tank varies directly with, cost to fill up, that's like y, varies directly with gallons purchased, it's like x, y varies directly with x. The meaning of that is y equals a times x. You can call it C and you can call it G and whatever letters you want to give it, but. That's what it's saying. This varies directly with. And that means that very specific thing of y equals a times x. Write that out. Okay. If this is y, this is x, the cost to fill up, and x is the number of gallons. They're saying that 13 gallon costs 14.46. 13 gallons times some A, it's going to be 14.46.
44.46.
What? 14. Okay, I'm going to easily. 44.46. Okay, you solve A by dividing by 13 on both sides. And A comes out to be
3.42.
Okay, so in our everyday life, what does 3.42 mean in this scenario?
$1 per, $3.42 per gallon.
Yep, dollars per gallon. That's a number we hear all the time. It's on the signs of every gas station out there. So it must be that y equals 3.42x. There it is. That's what I asked for, the equation. Yep.
So we're supposed to solve it.
And if it's asking for an equation that relates x and y, to put it shortly, then we need an equation that has x and y in it. And direct variation means y is equal to some constant times x. So we just need to find that constant. Given an example of 13 gallons cost 44.46, we can figure out what a is. So finding the equation of line gives you 2 points. A little bit of struggle still.
Yeah.
With this. So here we go again, and again, and again, and again, and again, until it seems like the majority of people are on board. So we have 2 points. We want to find the equation of a line. The equation of a line that's most common, that we like the most, y equals mx plus b, slope intercept 4. Is there something about that equation we can figure out?
Slope.
Y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Negative 4 plus 1 is negative 3. 4 plus 2, 6. Negative 1/2, that's our slope. We could, and it would be absolutely correct, to take this slope, plug it in there, take, say, this x there, that y there, or this x and this y. Or we could do this other thing that I'm going to do, which is use the point slope form. Remember, that's y minus y1 equals m times x minus x1. I'm going to do this with that slope, of course, and I'll say this point. Y minus negative 1 equals negative 1/2 times x minus negative 2. That's y plus 1 equals negative 1/2 times x plus 2. Distribute the negative 1/2. Subtract 1. Plugged in, or the person's paper that you're grading, plugged this into the slope intercept point, plug the x and y in there, solved for b and plugged it back in and wrote this equation. And that's great, that's 100% correct. That's a fine way to do it. Until I ask you to use the point slope form and you choose not to, the choice is yours. You can use either way you want. Hopefully what happened was last time, we were working on this again because we were having trouble with it. And you know, once we went over it, then it made more sense, but maybe not. So I'm gonna try to explain it in another way. So this function f, we can plug in, say, 3 to it, right? That's putting a 3 there means we need to plug 3 in for x. Well, where would it go? Wherever the x is, into both of these x's?
No.
Okay, so which x?
The bottom
one. The bottom one makes sense. The one that makes all equations equal, so the bottom one.
The bottom one? Why?
Because it's the one that makes the 3 makes that equation equal, makes it true.
Are you talking about this?
Yeah, if you plug 3 in there,
okay,
it's greater than 6.
So when you plug 3 in, well, for both of these x's, this one becomes true. This becomes false, so you want to use this one. So f of 3 equals 5/6 times 1 is 1. Cancels out, we're left with 2 down there. So that's 5/2 minus 1. I'll just get a common denominator here. 3/2. We put in 3, we got out 3/2. Same thing is said when I do this. F of 3 is 3/2. And the graph can represent that with a point. It represents it this way. Plugged in 3, and I got out 1/2, 2/2, 3/2. 3/2. There you go. There is one point on the graph. When I plug in 3 and I get out 3/2. Okay, let's try it again. Let's plug something else in for x. Not 3 this time. Let's say we want to plug in 0. Function, we plug that into
the top one.
The top one?
Yeah.
Top
unknown. Wait, why?
Because
isn't it less than? Oh wait, no, never mind. I thought
zero
that was
is
a positive.
Zero is actually bigger than negative numbers, right?
Never
zero
mind.
Is bigger than negative six, so we will again use the top or sorry the bottom function. We put zero in here, obviously we get negative one. I want to do f positive 6. Which function would I use?
Bottom one.
6 is bigger than negative 6. 5 sixths times 6 over 1. Minus 1. Cancel. 5 minus 1. That's 4.
Go.
6. 4. How about f of negative 6? We're going to use now. Still the bottom one, but we are just like barely still using the bottom function, right?
Mm-hmm.
Negative 6, is that if I'm going from right to left, that's the last number that I can plug in to the bottom function. Because as soon as I go past that, as soon as I go to the left of negative 6, I cross over and start using this function to get my output. So put in negative 6, that's 5, 6 times negative 6, that's 1, that's a negative 5, minus 1, negative 6. Negative 6, negative 6. Closed circle, because that is what I'm supposed to get out of the function, negative 6. Connect all these. There you go. Remember, for any x that is greater than or equal to negative 6, I use that bottom function. Or on the graph, for any x that is equal to or greater than negative 6, that's where that graph will be. That's where I will graph that graph. If you recognize that, you don't have to do all this work. You don't have to plug in x's and get out y's and find all these points. Okay. I know it's going to be a line. I know its y-intercept is negative 1. Its slope is 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There you go. That's a point we actually already found. But then as soon as I go over here, and I do like f of negative 9, now which function do I plug negative 9 into? The top function. We're over here. We're at negative 9. That is in the domain of the top function. Cancel. We're left with that. Let's see.
I did the wrong one.
I just got in that habit. It's 4/3. Negative 4/3 times negative 9. 1 minus 9. 3 cancel 3. 3 there. Negative 4 times negative 3 is 12. Minus 9 is 3. So negative 9. I need another point, right? How can I find another point? What's that? I can plug in negative 8. I'll get a fraction. And I can definitely graph that point. It's negative 8 comma something. Or how about, could I plug in negative 6 into that top function?
No.
OK. Is it physically possible for me to plug negative 6 into that x? It wouldn't be true for the function, and we wouldn't show that, but it would be helpful, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Like, I know that the line is going to be, like, coming at this, you know, some slope. Is it, like, going like this towards this point, or is it going like this towards that point? Like, what point should I go toward? I'm going to figure that out. So I can plug in negative 6 into that function, but then use an open circle rather than a closed circle. And then aim for the open circle, and that'll be my other point on that line. So, negative 4/3, negative 6, 1, minus 9, 2, so negative 8, no, positive 8, minus 9 is negative 1. So negative 6, negative 1.
Oh.
Should have done that, I should have done this. Because that point, it doesn't work for the function f of x, but it is where that line is headed, that top function is headed. So there we go. Just draw a line between those two. Because we are in the domain of this function for x's that are less than negative 6. Make any more sense than it did before we started talking about it?
Yeah.
So a little bit more.
I did it wrong again.
Yeah,
I didn't put mine on the negative
helped.
6.
Put it on what?
Yeah, this helped.
Just put it on the y-axis?
Yeah.
That's a common thing to do. But now you know. Like, you know the difference between what you did and what this is saying. So maybe after I look at the quizzes, I'll see.
Yeah.
All right, last one. Still having some trouble with it. So let me just review. I'm going to write a simpler equation, like 2x plus 3 is equal, the absolute value of 2x plus 3 is equal to 4x minus 7. No. Just use a number. Let's just say it equals 4. Okay, so what we have is some stuff, right? Lots of stuff is inside the absolute value, right? And once I plug something in for x and I get what that stuff is actually worth, we're gonna take the absolute value of that stuff, right? Of the stuff. Is that making sense? The word stuff? This stuff is worth some number.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take the absolute value of that stuff. Now what am I going to get when I take the absolute value?
4.
So the stuff inside here could be worth what?
4.
Also be worth?
Negative 4.
That's where those two equations come from. Every time we do an absolute value equation, we take the stuff and we say that it could be equal to 4. Right? It could be the same as 4. Or it could be negative 4. Stuff could be the same as 4. This stuff could be the same as negative. Right.
So when it says like check for extraneous. Yeah, is that when you like switch the signs?
That's when you plug the x's back in to this equation and see if it works.
Okay.
Let's check for extraneous solutions. So, very similarly. We say, even if there's x's on this side, because people aren't struggling too much with this, right? But I think it might be kind of a rote memorization thing. Set it equal to that, set it equal to negative that. If this thing comes out to be like 25, well, that'd be 25, and if this is equal to that, it works. The absolute value of 25 equals 25, right? Just for an example. So this stuff could be exactly the same as this stuff. That's what we're saying here. They could be identical. As long as this comes out to be positive. Because if this comes out to be negative, I would be saying that the absolute value of something is equal to a negative number, which is not possible. So if this stuff comes out to be positive, this equation works out. Always, this has to be positive. We're always assuming that this comes out to be positive. If it didn't, it wouldn't make any sense. Okay. So say that this comes out to be positive 16. Just kind of pretending it comes out to be 16. Well, then this stuff could be 16, or it could be negative 16, right? It could be opposite of that, as long as this is positive. This could be equal to, as long as this is positive, it could be equal to the negative version of that number, because if this is equal to negative that number, I'll take the absolute value of it and I'll get positive. So in both cases, we solve for x. So we get negative 2x equals 2, and x equals negative 1. Distribute the negative on this one. So we found one solution that we're going to need to test in just a second. Equals negative 5x plus 11. Add 5x, add 13, get 8x equals 24. X equals 3.
So yes. When you switch them is when you find the other solution?
With the switching the sign is finding the other solution. The checking, I'll even color code it, the checking part is when I take this and I plug it back into the equation. Okay? Don't have to put it into the whole equation, but I will this time and I'll show you why. There's like, we only need to look for this one particular outcome to see if it doesn't work. So I'll just plug it in. 3 times negative 1 minus 13 equals 5 times negative 1 minus 11. Inside here we get negative 3. Negative 3 minus 13. So we get negative 16. Right? Absolute value of negative 16 is what? Absolute
16.
Value of negative 16 is 16. But on this side of the equation, I get negative 11 minus 5, which is negative 16.
Doesn't work.
See, what happened was this stuff inside of the absolute value is equal to exactly the same as 5x minus 11, except for this came out to be negative. That's not possible. The absolute value of something can't be negative. So, plugging in negative 1 for x doesn't work. Call it an extraneous solution. We check out this guy right here. So, what do we really need to just verify? Why didn't this work?
Because there was a negative.
Because this right side came out negative. So, you can just check the right side. If it comes out positive, you're good to go. So, 5 times 3 minus 11, 15 minus 11. 4. It's positive, so it must be that the absolute value of negative 4 equals 4, and that's true. So that works. That's it. Ask questions if you have them. Score the quizzes. Reviews if you want. You're good to go. And so the thing that I asked you last time was, for example, do you think that fuel efficiency in the city and fuel efficiency in the highway are like related to each other? Like one could possibly tell you what the other one would be. If I knew the fuel efficiency in the city, I could make a good guess about what the fuel efficiency on the highway is.
Oh,
an estimate. Yeah, I probably can't do it exactly, but.
Probably like 10 more.
Yeah,
really.
Is there
like
10 more? Average, so it's, so it is kind of related, right?
Yeah.
There is almost an equation that I could write that would go from x to y. How about power and torque? Do you think there's maybe, not exactly, but kind of close?
Yeah. I
related
I
to each other? Okay. That would be. What we're saying here is, are they correlated? Okay, and it seems to be, it seems like power and torque are correlated, that they're related to each other in some way. How about, now think about this, the price of a vehicle and the weight of that vehicle. The price of a vehicle and the weight of the vehicle.
No, the Prius. The Prius are in the way.
Well, okay, well, if that's the only one, so maybe we can make a guess. What do you think? You think that if I told you how much a car costs, you could be like, that car probably weighs about this much?
Probably, just because you have
to close, but
get
like, I don't know.
Well, what about the
Suburban's
Ferrari thing that you got?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
What about the Lambos and the Ferraris? They're not very heavy.
They are very heavy. They're very expensive. So maybe kind of like more materials do cost more money And material weighs an amount, right? So maybe there's some kind of correlation, but does it seem like it's as closely related as fuel efficiency city and fuel efficiency highway?
That one's actually like close.
This is really, said like if you add 10, it almost works for all of them. Yeah, 10, that's pretty close there. A little bit off there, so close.
A long drop.
So,
thank you, Ben.
Some things seem like they are closely correlated or highly correlated is what we would say. And other things seem to be not as correlated. Right? So that's what we're gonna look at. But what if I were to draw a graph? If I thought that fuel efficiency city and fuel efficiency highway were correlated to each other, and I were to graph this like X and this like Y, X and Y, what do you think that graph would tell me about how correlated they are? What is that?
They'd be like very correlated.
Okay, so I see that they're following a pattern of some kind. Okay, and if they weren't correlated, like they wouldn't look like they're making any kind of shape together.
They'd just be all over.
All over. Okay, good. So let's take a look at some of these graphs. Here's a good question. How many graphs are possible?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30.
36?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, yours includes price versus price. Price is highly correlated with price. If you tell me the price, I can tell you the price.
Yeah.
It's not a very like good graph. So maybe it comes down to 30, but then some of those are just backwards. Like this would be X and this would be Y, and switch it, this is X and this is Y. So those would be the same graph, essentially.
25.
So just a question. Maybe you could think about it, figure it out. That's a different subject. Let's look at this graph. This is the x-axis is always this guy right here. The y-axis is this one. So fuel efficiency city versus fuel efficiency highway. Do these seem to be correlated?
No.
Except
for
that one.
That's a Prius.
That's
gotta
be the Prius,
that
right?
Gotta be the Prius.
Okay. Let's look at this next one.
Can't go over.
Price versus weight.
Yeah,
close. Is it as close as this?
No.
Except for the Prius.
But why is the Prius? The question really is.
That's not the Prius, I don't think.
That's the Prius. This
that's
one right here.
Prius is that thing up there.
Prius
got
Prius is
the
a
highest fuel
efficiency.
Fuel efficiency is
high.
Okay, but here's the question. It's not so much as, like. This one isn't close to these ones. Guys, it's not that this one needs to be close to these ones, right? This one has the fuel efficiency that it has.
It's on like the same line.
Okay, so now we're getting somewhere. It seems to be close to on the same line of best fit. So you guys have talked about the line of best fit before?
Yeah, it has like 20 of those on my map's best fit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh
my
God.
Yeah.
Well, since we're there, does somebody want to come up and, like, is there a line that goes through all these points?
Yeah.
Yes.
All these?
No.
I
mean,
like,
the, like, average
goes,
of it.
Okay, like, the average. Who wants to draw the line that they think is the best line?
No, dude, that's okay.
Pull a squeeze, dude.
Yeah.
Or you can get a line,
though,
too.
Line to,
like,
you
gotta go from
color
the origin.
Again.
That was
so That is a good line. Do you think it's the best line?
No.
I bet it's not. I bet. I bet on Brennan's first try, he didn't come up with the best line.
Nope.
Now we're not going to have to worry about finding the best line by hand. We're going to find it with technology, but finding it by hand, here's basically how it works. So if we take the distance here from the point to the line, and this distance here, this one, and this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. All these distances from the point to a line, added them all up, what would the line of best fit? Like, what would be true about the line of best fit? The sum of all that, I'm saying, add this distance to that one, to that one, to that one. Lowest possible number that you could get. The lowest possible sum of all those distances that you could possibly get. Okay? And that is the idea. And so you can see how finding all of those distances would be tedious. Not that difficult, not that complex, but tedious. So we'll use technology to do that, shortcut that for us. Okay? Because we want to really know, like, how do we interpret that line?
How long do you have close to this line?
Well, we'll have to find that line of best fit. Well, how would we know how close it is to your line? How would we compare them?
We're pulling up right there.
Pulling up right there. Well,
where is that?
How about we would need like an equation for the line, right? And compare the equations of the line.
Yeah,
compare
two
the y-intercept.
Find the slopes.
2 points and find the slope.
That's right. Okay.
2 points and find the slope. Okay. Do I have to pick one of the points from the data set?
No.
No, just anything on the line.
You pick 0, 0.
Something
zero,
on the line. Does it have to go through 0, 0?
No, my line does.
Your line does. Okay, so we'll pick 0, 0. That certainly doesn't.
And
make
then
it
there's like 50, 40.
Yeah.
40, 50, sorry.
40, 50?
Yeah.
Yep.
That's pretty close.
40, 50? 30, 40.
30, 40? That's a little, that's not as close as
not
this.
Quite.
So this is the 50.
Yeah.
In fact, let's call it 51. Let's call it 40, 51. Oh, 0, 0.
We're going that. It's like 0, 1.
Fair enough.
Yeah, no, you just fixed it, didn't you?
Yep. Okay, 51. Minus 1 over 40 minus 0.
Oh
my God. Friends.
Nice, Brennan.
50 over 40. 5 over 4.
Not a boy.
Brennan, just like, no, I don't want to be.
So the equation of this line is y equals 5 fourths x plus
b.
B, which is?
0. 1.
1. Because that's what you said it was. Fair enough. But it's kind of a funny data point. I mean, the data, the best fit to the data is the best fit to the data. It just is what it is. And mostly these lines work within a set of data. If we start to extrapolate that to other things, let's see what this y-intercept would mean. This is fuel efficiency in the city. This is fuel efficiency on the highway. So what would this point mean?
That would be when you're stopped and you're chugging up gas.
No. This has nothing to do with your speed. What does the X represent?
Fuel efficiency.
Which does the Y represent?
Highway.
This is a car with zero fuel efficiency in the city.
Oh.
Has an efficiency of 1 mile per gallon.
So
you don't want that
car.
The
ratio?
Wow.
Well, that's the comparison. Now wait, could a car actually have it's 0 miles to the gallon?
No.
No, there's no such a car doesn't exist.
That's pretty much true.
And if it did get 0, this graph is saying if it did get 0 miles to the gallon in the city, it would get 1 mile per gallon on the highway. Well, how could it?
That's a
how could you get
right
0 miles in the city? Like, I couldn't drive out of the city to get to the highway. Right? To get 1 mile per hour.
Push it.
So,
What if he gets towed?
So, like I said, this line really, it's meant to fit our data, and so it works within where the data lies. Okay? There's no data over here. There's not any cars that get 0 miles to the gallon. There might be some cars that get 1 mile to the gallon, but I don't know what they are. I don't know who's driving them. Maybe like a monster truck or something.
Like a monster truck towing a semi-trailer?
Probably just a semi in general.
With like
maybe a semi in general?
On the tires, so you can't move.
Okay, so what do we say? Is this highly correlated?
Yeah.
It's high. That's not highly correlated. Highly correlated. Let's look at that word correlated.
Related.
Co-related. Right? Related with each other. Co means with, related means related. Right? So they're related to each other. Correlated. All right, let's look at this next guy.
No.
Price versus weight. Is there some kind of correlation?
Not really.
A little bit because more stuff that weighs more does cost money, and so that company needs to recuperate some of that money, but what a car costs is not decided by how much it weighs.
Nope.
It's decided by
the heated seats, quality of the
heated
steering.
Yeah. How much it actually costs? If it,
manual
windows or power windows, the amenities
sunroof.
It has.
Manual or automatic?
Sunroof.
That's
the
difference.
Yeah.
Sunroof. Way less costly.
Okay.
Leather.
Or it's a really, like, it's so light. It took a lot of effort to make it that light, and therefore costs a lot of money because it took a lot of effort to make it that light, right? That looks like maybe, like this car's pretty light, but pretty expensive. What do you think that is?
Probably the Impala.
No, isn't that one
weighty
but less expensive?
What's that?
Priest. Isn't that one weighty but less expensive?
Oh, I was looking at backwards. Yeah, it's less expensive, but pretty heavy. So maybe like a really cheap SUV or something.
Yeah.
It's the Honda.
It's a Kia or something.
Yeah, I just said Kia.
Oh.
Okay, this one is pretty expensive, but fairly light. Prius is actually, I think this guy right here is like 24th. No, it's 24 is like, I think it's that guy.
Could be a Nissan Central.
Could be the Impala.
Which car is the one that's like lighter than the Prius? Because there's a couple of them.
I don't know. Maybe
Nissan
Central.
The Elantra.
But is it correlated? Yeah, kind of, but not very. Okay, we'll actually find a number value that tells us how closely correlated are there. This number will be between -1 and +1. Can you put the phone away, please? Give all the phones away, please. All the phones away. Away. Goodbye, phones.
Goodbye.
Like, away.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Sorry, I had a teacher give a presentation at the teacher's conference, and it has a box for phones. I think it'll start that because it's getting ridiculous. Okay, so they seem to be correlated, but not very highly correlated. So this number, okay, would be close-ish to 0 because it would not be very correlated. If it were more correlated, like this, it would be closer to 1. Okay, closer to 1 because these are more closely correlated. Let's jump over to this guy right here. Someone want to come up and draw the line that they think is the best fit to the data?
Charlie.
I will.
Just do it.
That was a
right
inverse
into
relationship.
Was that? Was that
an inverse relationship?
That's an interesting
observation.
Let's see if Brennan agrees.
It's legit.
Okay. It might be a direct relationship.
I mean,
it looks pretty inverse.
It's looking like an inverse.
Yeah.
Yeah, keep looking. Not too good. There we go.
Oh,
I just
Thank you. Very good. Okay.
Thank you.
Just for asking if it's an inverse relationship, because if we get too used to this line, it goes up and to the right, up and to the right, up and to the right. I've seen people do this, and it's not unreasonable to kind of try and do what you've seen, but which line seems to follow the pattern of data the best?
Brennan's.
Brennan's line. What's this?
That's a Prius.
That's a Prius. Now, does a Prius seem to be in keeping with this pattern?
Not really.
No, it does not. Let's go back here. You see the Prius here as well.
All by itself.
Is it as far off the pattern as this other guy?
No.
So this one's what we call more of an outlier. Because it's really messing up the rest of the data, right? If it weren't for that Prius, this line would be like just going straight through all those points.
With no problem.
Outlier. Messing it up. I mean, really, the line of best fit is probably more like this because of that Prius. Pulling it up towards the Prius.
No.
Yeah.
You'd think it would.
Because then all. But once you do that, like six other points get further away from the line and compound.
I may be exaggerating a bit to make you see how the Prius is pulling it off. So
you're gonna get like a point.
Well, we could find two points that appear to be on the line, and we could write the slope and plug it into the point slope form and write the equation of the line, right? That would be our guess at the line of best fit. There is a way to find the best fit line, and it'll give you the equation. Let's see how to do that in a sec. Well, so what did you call this, Isaac? This relationship, you called it a what?
Inverse.
Inverse, okay. Well, inverse is a little tricky. Inverse, well, it implies something else. Like you're talking to a mathematician, you say inverse, that means something else.
Yeah.
It would actually be a curvy thing. But what we call this, like what kind of a line is this? What kind of a slope does this have? Negative slope. So it's called negative
correlation.
What kind of correlation does a C like these have? Positive. Right? The slope of the best fit line would be positive, so it would be positive correlation. But this one seems like not very correlated. We got positive, we got negative, and then we have not very correlated, not really seemingly correlated at all. Okay. How about these? These seem to be very highly correlated.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah, it's really close to a straight line. There's not even really any outliers. It seems like your power and your torque. Like honestly, I don't fully understand
the
difference between power and torque.
Power is
so.
Power and torque is your
foot pounds. Not foot per pound.
Prettiest is the one.
Okay.
So, like, power and torque, they are different. They are different, but they are so similar to each other. It's not surprising that they're highly correlated.
Yeah.
And that number that I was talking about, that tells you how highly correlated they are. So the number here would be close to one. That number that we talk about is called R. R is close to one here. How about this one? What do you think R is close to here? Should it be close to negative one? Because they are fairly correlated. Not really, right? Not as much as the power and torque. They are correlated to each other. It's pretty good. So that number is going to be closer to negative one because there's a negative correlation. Closer to negative one than it would be to zero, right? Remember I said this number R is between negative one and one.
I think it's the wind.
Where's my windmill?
Look at the tree. What?
All those leaves shaking, dude.
Okay.
Good story.
And how about price and torque?
Not at all.
No. Doesn't seem very correlated at all. So here, that number R, what do you think it'd be close to? One, negative one, zero. The worse the correlation, the closer this number goes to the center of zero. Negative correlation, really good negative correlation, negative one. Really good positive correlation, positive one. If it were perfectly correlated and it was exactly one, that would mean all the data was perfectly on a line.
There's a lot of new terms.
All right. So we all have our calculators. If you don't, go grab one.
Yes, we did.
A few of you.
Yes, we did.
Got it.
Okay. So there's a lot of data points, and so this is going to. I can put it up on the board though. All right. So either you're listening to me or you're listening to me. Those are the choices.
Listening to you.
Okay. All right. So we got our calculator. Now we need to give the calculator this data, not all of it, but quite a bit. We're going to need to enter this data and this data, or this data and this data, whatever we want to see how closely correlated they are. Okay. So I think that power and torque were, when I was looking at those graphs, they were really closely correlated. Okay. So I want to see how correlated they are. So follow with me. I'm going to go to the button marked stat. And then we're just going to hit enter and edit.
Oh, wait, I found it.
What is stat bar?
Yeah, what's.
Don't worry about it, just
one bar, two
keep,
bar.
Keep with me.
What?
Stat bar?
This is not what
I'm doing.
Clear these out.
I'm up with you.
I'm not.
Char, you're on something.
Crap.
Yeah.
Either you're here or you need
my
help.
Goodness.
You need a graph.
I'll get me
something. Yeah, I was like, this isn't working.
Yeah, I was like,
you gotta hit stat, then enter Charmeleon.
You gotta put,
no,
there's
not
a little tab data.
Oh,
you
got
press that.
Just kidding.
Is there right there?
There's
no
polish on
there. Oh, that's great.
If you have stuff in here, you need to clear it out. You need to go up, move your cursor up to there, and press clear. Clear, and then press enter, and then just the dot delete. Don't press delete. Press clear.
I'm lost.
Oh, I'm on page view now.
It's
right
there.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, press enter now and edit. Bottom right. Okay, so we need to enter this. I'm going to do power and torque. Okay? Power and torque.
Okay.
You can all do whichever you want. Go up, press clear right there. All right, here we go.
Okay.
So, I'm going to enter all of the prices. No, I'm not going to enter that. I'm going to enter all the powers, okay? Now, you have to be really careful. You have so much data you're entering. You just want to enter it carefully so that you don't accidentally put two numbers in one line. You don't skip one as you're reading it. Right? Be really methodical about this, because if you leave one out, it's hard to go back and figure out what got left out or what got entered twice or whatever. So, I'm going to just look at this very top number, 302.
I'm doing the top one.
Press enter. Next, 285. And next, 178. And so on. Okay? You, what?
That's happier.
Yeah. So you pick those two columns that you want. I'll put them up here, the PDF up here. Okay. Pick two columns, enter those two columns. The first column goes in L1, the second column goes in L2. These are your X's, these are your Y's. X's?
I don't know, it's just L3 and
W's
or something.
Huh?
What's L3?
Something else.
Bad thing.
We just need two lists. We just need X's and Y's. Okay? So that's it. So go through and enter the first column in L1, the second column in L2, and then when we're done with that, we'll continue. And there it is right there. You can use that. It's about as zoomed in as I can get. Okay. All we've done is leave that list. We haven't done that much. We've just left the lists by pressing second, quit.
Try that.
Now,
no, dude.
Right here where I pointed at. Quit. Second, quit.
Quit.
Okay, now, press that again. Now we're going to go over to Calc. Okay? We're going to use what's called a linear linear regression.
Linear regression.
You see ax plus b, like mx plus b, it's going to give us that equation. Okay. Now, all I have to do is press enter, it's going to give me an equation for a line.
So how do we...
Okay. For an equation of the form y equals, say, mx plus b, m is this, that's the slope, this is the y-intercept, and this is my r, okay? And I'm thinking that I made a mistake somewhere there.